Thank you so much. You may be seated. I'm going to, if you join me, in the book of James. And we're going to be in the book of James, chapter 1. And my approach tonight, for those of you that are with us in the house and those of you online, join us, book of James, this is going to be simple but profound. We're going to do both. We're going to make it simple, but we're going to make some profundity out of it because the Word of God is profound. Amen? Yes. All by itself. My approach tonight is expository teaching. I'm going to walk you through an expository teaching. This is an approach that details the text in other ways that don't. I teach, you know, I minister topical. You've heard me. You've been hearing me long enough through the years and how I minister, but tonight I'm going to do something a little different with you as I've been doing at Truth Center. I'm actually walking Truth Center through the entire New Testament verse by verse. And it's a little different from topical teaching that's driven by the topic, but this is driven by the Bible. And I find it causes, I think I like the verse-by-verse approach because it's comprehensive. It leaves a little room for interpretive error. and it gives the maximum of the richness of the text to invade us. Because that's what the text should do. It should invade us, right? We should find ourselves in the text. Amen? And so we're going to launch ourselves in James chapter 1, and I'm going to talk a little bit about James. We're going to read the entire chapter through, and then I'll go back and unpack each verse for us. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for your grace. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the time that we have spent already in your presence, the worship. The hearts and minds are already open, ready to receive. And we ask, Holy Spirit, you are the smartest person on the planet. Give us what we need. You know this text because you wrote it. Interpret it for us tonight, and we ask so graciously in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. James, a servant of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in the dispersion, greetings. Count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like the wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded, unstable in all his ways man. Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation, because like a flower of the grass he will pass away, for the sun rises with its scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flower falls and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those who love him. Let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God, for God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it conceives, gives birth to sin. When sin, when it is fully grown, brings forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of lights, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be a kind of first fruits of his creatures. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of man does not produce righteousness of God. Therefore, put away filthiness, rampant wickedness, and receive with meekness the implanted word, which is able to save your souls. But be doers of the word, not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For anyone is a hearer of the word and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his natural face in a mirror, for he looks at himself and goes away and once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law of liberty perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts. He will be blessed in his doing, and if anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God the Father is this: to visit the orphans and widows in their affliction and keep oneself unstained from the world. The word of the Lord. God's word is good, isn't it? It's just good to just read it sometimes. Just to, you know, just read it. Just let it saturate your mind and your heart. James is the half-brother of Jesus. Considered during the time of about 40 to 60 CE, he was the overseer and bishop of the Christian community found in Jerusalem. This is equivalent to being the head of all Christianity, because the community was not that large. So he was pretty much the head of all of it. All this occurred in Jerusalem before the destruction of the temple in 70 AD. Now, Jewish people measure their history by the destruction of the temple and the temple being built and destroyed again. Temples are very significant in Jewish history. The Romans invaded Jerusalem and besieged it in 70 AD, and Jerusalem was the Christian headquarters. The siblings of Jesus are mentioned in Matthew chapter 13, 55 through 56, and I'm going to be throwing another number of scriptures at you tonight. 1 Corinthians 15, 7 mentions James as the one Jesus appeared first to after the resurrection, and then the other disciples. His belief in his brother, James that is, didn't really happen until after the resurrection. And so James, after the crucifixion, remained in Jerusalem and became a staple in the community of believers. He was part of the group of believers praying in the upper room. But James begins his letter here in chapter 1, verse 1, and he never mentions Jesus as his brother. Here's how he says. He says, but a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. He never assumes upon his relationship with his brother. He had Jesus in the right place. And this gives us insight into how he viewed his brother. Unlike some of his other siblings, and we can talk about them, we ain't got time, he recognized him as Lord God. And this is really profound when you think about it. James was a wise leader. And Paul describes him in Galatians chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. He describes James as an influential pillar of the church. His reputation among the believers was stellar, sort of like Stephen. You know, when you lead people, it helps to have a good reputation. Okay? You need the people's respect. You can't teach those that don't respect you. So Paul, who was called to minister to the Gentiles, he was supported by James and answerable to the Jerusalem council led by James. James was the leader, as I already stated, of the Jerusalem council. Acts 15, 13 through 21 gives you a little bit of insight. It was his accounting of God's word from Amos chapter 9, where he speaks about the Gentiles who would be called by the name of God. James had a nickname. James's nickname was Old Camel Knees, because he was found in the temple praying and he developed calloused knees from being on his knees all the time. So much so, his knees became hard. James was a pastor to pastors. And he gets right to the point in the book here. The book of James is the how-to book on Christianity, on the Christian life. It gives clear, practical How to Live Christian Life Models and Examples. It walks you through the life. James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ to the 12 tribes in the dispersion. Greetings. Count it all joy, brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds, for you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness, and let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith, with no doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose he will receive anything from the Lord. He is double-minded and unstable in all his ways. Let the lowly brother boast in his exaltation, and the rich in his humiliation, because he's like a flower of the grass. He will pass away. For the sun rises with scorching heat and withers the grass. Its flower falls, and its beauty perishes. So also with the rich man fade away in the midst of his pursuits. Let's unpack verses 1 through 11. He writes to the 12 tribes the intent of this letter. The intent of the letter is that it would be passed around to the various local assemblies outside his home in the area of Palestine. Verses 2 through 4, James's perspective is different when it comes to trials. He considers it testing of our faith, necessary for that great virtue called patience to come forth. How many realize you need patience? Yeah, you need it. You need it. You can't do this without patience. Patience is not only necessary, it's a must-have. God will produce and allow things in your life so that he can get the patience out of you that he needs. Have you noticed that living for God requires an extreme amount of patience at all times? Testing is used to refer to being not only tested, but approved. God gives the approval. Patience here is not just about bearing affliction, but it's about standing under pressure. This alone should serve to inform the believer of what to expect in walking with Jesus. This will require a kind of faith resistant to circumstances. And I said this, we were in Guyana last week, and I was doing some teaching, and it came to me. You know, I sit on the board of a seminary, and we have a lot of African students. And in Africa, they've gotten this perverted understanding of faith. You know where they got it? From faith, the faith movement in America. The faith movement primarily is a me-centered faith. That they teach a me-centered. Everything is about me. More money, more this, more that. Jesus said something in the book of Luke, and this is what he says. When I return, will I find faith in the earth? I realize I ministered that word to you all the last time I was here. Is Jesus talking about faith for money? Is he talking about faith for your health and your wealth? What is he really talking about? He's talking about faith that endures circumstances. Faith that pushes back on anything that intrudes the space that Jesus occupies in your life. Faith resistant to circumstances. That's the faith he's looking for. In all this, James is asking you to think about your trials as pure joy, because when you context a thing the way it is, what you believe about a thing is what it is actually in your life. If you believe it's tough, then it's going to be tough. If you believe, you look at your situations and recontext them, reframe them, and say, this is going to be joy. It's going to be joy. And could absolutely not appear as joy, but you can turn it into joy like that, based on how you define it. Because how you define a thing is what you believe it to be. And all James is asking you to think about your trials is pure joy. This is why his perspective is totally different. In verse 5, the wisdom James is referring to is not at all about information. This wisdom we locate in Proverbs chapter 9, verse 10. And here's what it says. The fear of the Lord is what? Come on, you scholars, you know, is the beginning of what? The fear of the Lord starts the wisdom. And the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. The beginning of this particular wisdom, or the obtaining of it, begins with the fear of the Lord. That's a big problem in the body of Christ, folks. People don't fear God. If they did, they stopped doing this foolishness that they do. You must walk around with a reverence for God so that you can be the same person in the dark that you are before people. Hallelujah. Amen, walls and floor. And God is looking for consistency. Not fakes and phonies. Not people that look good just and appear a certain way in front of the pastor or the leaders. Be who you are when nobody's around. Well, you need to be. The fear of the Lord is reverence for God, because you cannot, again, you cannot learn from who you don't respect. And we are all here to be taught by God, right? Nicodemus got it wrong in John 3. He said, I know you are a great teacher, sent by God to teach. No, he wasn't sent by God to teach. It was God who was doing the teaching. He got it wrong. God come to teach. Not sent by God to teach. We are here being taught by God through his word. Without reverence or respect of God, you cannot be taught. And then the scriptures teach us that Satan's wisdom was corrupted by pride. Ezekiel 28, verse 17. Those who have wisdom in spiritual things, listen to me real good, receive that wisdom because they asked for it. You just have to ask for it. But there's a catch. There's a caveat. When we continually fill our hearts with as much of God's wisdom as we can take in, it multiplies. Remember what Jesus said in Mark chapter 4, verse 24 and 25. He said, pay attention to what you hear. Because with the measure that you use, it will be measured to you. And still more will be added. But here's a catch in verse 25. For to the one who has, more will be given. And from the one who has not, even what he has will be taken away. How do you take something from somebody who ain't got nothing? You know how? They don't realize they got it. Did you catch that? And a lot of folks don't even realize what they got in Christianity. You ain't got to be hoping that you make it in. You in already. Lord, help us. You already in. So stop this foolishness. Lord, I'm trying to make it in. You in. Now live like you in. Wisdom doesn't stay if it's not reinforced. Wisdom has to be reinforced. It's similar to learning a foreign language. A student who studies for years and spends time in the environment where the language is spoken, they will understand more and more, become more fluent in the ways that can't be taught formally. My nephew went down to Bogota. He spent about a month there. That boy was speaking Spanish so fast. I mean, he's a bright kid. He was speaking the language with people. But now that he's out of it, and again, but if they study for a while, then stop practicing the language, they'll quickly lose everything they learn. Another important fact about wisdom is this. It's not given based on merit, but only because you asked for it. Somebody say hallelujah. That's good news. This wisdom leads to insight, the ability to see with clarity that God controls all circumstances regardless of what you see. That's what got me through COVID. I knew he was in control, regardless of what happens. And here's the other thing, and this may be a little tough for some of y'all, but I ain't afraid to die. And when you live and you ain't afraid to die, you can live. You can actually start living. So you must understand what James is saying here. Any person who doubts, in verse 61, the one caveat regarding wisdom is this: you have to ask in faith. And you must understand what James is saying here. Any person that doubts God's wisdom or God's willingness to give this wisdom is also unlikely to accept what God gives. These people will consult other sources, because you got Christians looking at other sources, you know. There's only one spirit guide in the kingdom. It's the Holy Spirit. Anything else is of the devil. One spirit guide. In James's day, these sources included idols. In our day, we have all kind of worthless sources, a bunch of stuff on social media. James is leading the reader into his word about double-mindedness. He's leading them into it. You must also understand, all we have talked about so far requires faith, especially this part about wisdom. Verse 7, believe God will give it to you. Believe God will give it to you. Verse 7, for that person must not suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. You have to believe God will give it to you. Don't doubt. Don't come halfway. Because a double-minded person is a two-soul person. This is a person with half mind toward God and half mind somewhere else. The reality is a person with two souls. Matthew 6:24 speaks about this. No one can serve two what? For either he will hate the one, love the other, or he will be devoted to the one despised. You cannot serve God and mammon. And I can get into a whole lot of stuff with that, because that's the only verse where anything is put on the level of God. And mammon is a dangerous spirit. They will hate the one. Let me just unpack a little bit about mammon real quick. The reason why Jesus spoke this, he puts it on the level of God. Mammon is not God, but it can replicate God. You say, Pastor, how does it do that? God is omnipresent. If you got enough money, you can be everywhere. God is omniscient. If you got enough money, you can buy the greatest minds in the world. And God is omnipotent. If you got enough money, it makes you feel like you're all powerful. So it fakes the characteristics of God, but it makes people who have it feel like they're God. And it's a dangerous thing. And there's a whole lot more to that. But you will hate one and love the other. There will be a constant conflict inside. And verses 9 and 10 gives us a peek into James's mind as to he speaks about the double-minded person. People who trust in mammon, James offers two examples of trials: the lowly brother and the rich brother. The lowly brother should count it all joy that God is building his character through the circumstances. This in reality is God exalting this lowly brother. This is another attempt by James to change the perspective of his reader. But the rich brother should also glory when he's brought low, because it's designed to teach him where to place his faith. Never in possessions. Folks, where are the things that you think you own, because you don't own nothing? But let me help you. Where are the things that you think you own loosely? So if God came and said, you know, I want you to give this away. Give it to Sister So-and-so. You can do it like that. Wear the things that you, because you take nothing from this planet. We are stewards of everything, possessors of nothing. Not even them kids you think are yours. They belong to God. Anyway, that's a whole nother story. Verse 11, it tells us it all fades away like withering grass, like a vapor. It appears one moment and disappears the next. The entire context of this study is about enduring. To endure trials is more about trusting God than anything else, because perseverance, if you're taking notes, please write this down. Perseverance always outlasts persecution. It always will. You will reap if you faint not. He that endures to the end shall what? Come on. Perseverance always outlasts persecution. So the theme behind James, I like to use this example about Martin Luther, the great reformer. You know, Martin Luther came along and he reformed. He protested, which is where we get the Protestant church. It's a protest against the indulgences of the Catholic Church and all the other stuff that they were involved in, and the structure of Catholicism, which said a person has to be between me and God. I got to go to him to repent. And no, Martin Luther said, and he read something in Romans. He said, and the just shall live by faith. By what? So the world does not need, and this is what Martin Luther said, the world does not need a definition of religion as much as it needs a demonstration. So stop talking and live it. Yeah. That's pretty much the idea here. And the context of the whole book of James, it's a call to put our faith in the gospel in action. That's what it is. And if anybody did it, James did it. Verse 12. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under trial, for when he has stood the test of time, he will receive the crown of life which God promised to those who what? Who love him. The believers receive crowns and rewards for enduring temptation, being steadfast under trial, or suffer loss for failure to do so. There are two sides to it. You know, there can be some regret at the Bema seat. The Bema seat is the judgment seat of Christ. That's what it's called. The Bema seat. There's going to be some regret there. You're going to get in, people will get into heaven, but they're going to get into heaven as being singed. I like to say, they've been burnt. Because you're going to be burnt by what Jesus is going to say to you. What did you do with me all the years you've been alive? Were you self-centered? Did you express me to others? Did you exercise faith in the midst of tough times? Or did you capitulate to the circumstances? 2 Corinthians 5:10, for we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he has done in the body, whether good or evil. So what happens at the judgment seat? Number one, the word says appear, to make visible, we stand before the Lord with our true character revealed. Ain't no hiding at that point. We receive to get the equivalent of what's due to you. The believer will either be approved or ashamed. And 1 Corinthians 3:14 says, if the work that anyone has built on the foundation survives, he will receive a reward. But verse 15 says, if anyone's work is burned up, he will suffer loss, though he himself will be saved, as only through fire. TC loves when I do that. The truth of God's word should dramatically change the way we live, because our actions will be evaluated by the master. You know, I always have him in the back of my mind. Okay, how is he seeing me do this? Is he approving of this? When you live like that, you live with a consciousness of, you know what, I'm going to keep my act together, do what I need to do, keep myself on course. Amen. Not being condemned, but I want to make him happy. Yeah. I want him to approve and be, I want him to say, Keith, you did a good job, son. Now I want to make you leader over this nation over here. You go. That's what I want to hear. Verse 13, notice the focus of the chapter changes in verse 13. Let no one say when they are tempted, I am being tempted by God. Okay, you go through that whole temptation piece. Notice the focus changes from trial to temptation. Laws of temptation. No one will ever be tempted by God. Get that out of your vocabulary. God don't tempt nobody. He cannot be tempted by evil. Enticement to sin never comes from God. It's an important point to understand. Verse 14, God would never deliberately lead a person to sin. That's against his nature. This is in direct opposition to God molding us into his holy image. Sin does not force itself on the unwilling. It must be chosen. So God will allow adversity to mold character. He did it, Genesis 22, Abraham, Isaac. He let adversity mold them guys. Temptation is the fruit of lust inside someone's heart, drawing them. Temptation is the fruit of lust inside somebody's heart, drawing them. Human desire has been mismanaged since the garden. And guys, I'm going to talk to y'all about this tomorrow in detail. So we're going to unpack this stuff tomorrow. We're going to put it under a magnifying glass. But let me give an overview of what I'm going to say tonight. We are given a before and after picture of human desire here. Genesis chapter 2, verse 9. If you got your Bibles, turn to it because you're going to want to see this. And out of the ground the Lord God made to spring up every tree that is pleasant to the sight and good for food. Did you hear that? Pleasant to the what? Sight and good for what? Now this is before sin. This is chapter 2. The tree of life was in the midst of the garden and the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Pleasant to the eye is about desire. God is your number one desire, which aligns all your other human desires. When he is not the priority, every desire you have is going to be out of alignment. Good for food is about need. So we are, when we manage our desires, we are to desire what we need. Because he said, I will what? Supply all your what? So we should desire what we need. It's important to understand this. But after sin, look what happened. Sin was introduced in verse 3, chapter 3, verse 6. It says, so when the woman saw that the tree was now what? Good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes. You see the inversion? And that the tree was to make one wise. What you have here is all three sins: lust of the flesh, lust of the eyes, pride of life, right here. And she took the fruit and ate it, and she also gave some to her husband, that idiot, who was with her. Dummy. They made it to heaven, but he gonna have the longest line of people, because I'm gonna be on that line. I just wanna look him in the face and say, man, what the hell? What was on your mind? That you would betray God. The scripture says he was not deceived, she was. But you can't sin without being deceived to some degree. So there's a little play on the word there. Because he sinned willfully. But he bought into her. Good for food is need, right? Delight to the eye is desire. So when desire is mismanaged, you feel you need what you desire. You see that? Oh, I need a husband. No, you don't. You need Jesus. You might want a husband, but you don't need a husband. You need water, food, shelter, And God said what? In Matthew 6, he said, I will supply all your needs. He said, seek first what? The kingdom. Keep me in the place where I need to be so I can correct all your desires. So I can help you manage yourself. Because most believers can't manage themselves. All right, that's enough of that. Desire for things God has forbidden. Desire for things, this is a statement by a guy named Sam Alberry. Sam Alberry. Remember that name. Sam Alberry. He's a pastor. Tremendous theologian. Same sex attracted. Y'all hear me? Same sex attracted. He's attracted to men. But he never fulfilled it because he puts Jesus first. He wrestles with that part of his life and can break it down and help people who struggle with that area. He does a tremendous job. But he constantly said, Lord, help me in this area. Don't have a wife. He keeps his body under. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? Yes. He's managed that desire. Keeps nailing it to the cross. This is what Sam says. Desires for things God has forbidden are a reflection of how sin has distorted me, not how God made me. Are y'all hearing me? That man got it right. I say his name intentionally because the LGBTQ, the alpha, too many, they're gonna add some more tomorrow. That is the greatest challenge for the church today, dealing with that community. And how to deal with it. But this man, read some of his stuff, profound guy. Verse 15, lust conceives and births children called sin. Sin has its own offspring called death. Note the word. It says, when it is full grown. That means some of us may be dabbling somewhere right now, but it ain't full grown yet. And if you continue, it will grow up. And it'll bring death to whatever it is. Now, this death here is talking about physical death. But it can also be talking about spiritual death. Sin has a maturation stage when what was conceived reaches completion. The completion in the garden occurred when she ate, then he ate, then the offspring called death was born. Death, again, means primarily physical, but also spiritual. This is when it was introduced in the garden. Verses 16 and 17, James gives a warning about being deceived. And we see the same thing in 1 Corinthians 15, verse 33, and Galatians 6, 7. James establishes where goodness flows from. He says it comes from the Father of lights. He also shares God's character. He says there's no variation in God and ain't no change. Verse 18, we were born of the word of truth, he says, and by his own will he chose us. I like what 2 Thessalonians 13 says, but we ought always give thanks to God for you, brothers beloved by the Lord, because God chose you as a first fruit to be saved through the sanctification by the Spirit and belief in the truth. This is consistent with all of Scripture about how we are saved. We were dead in our trespasses and sin. You know that Scripture? We were dead in our trespasses and sin until God made us what? Alive. God gave us the faith to believe. Yet, unlike Calvinism, which teaches we had no choice when presented with salvation, they call it irresistible grace. Grace is applied to those predetermined to be saved, not of their own free will. That's what they say. We don't say that. We subscribe to the idea humans have a free will, to choose. And the word dead here is the issue. We believe dead to mean spiritually, it means spiritually not dead as unable to respond. If we were unable to respond, then the scripture wouldn't say, don't harden your heart. Are you with me? Which means you can't harden your heart. Basic concept, if God is love, love always is a choice. You with me? If it's not, it's coerced. Verse 19 and 20. Know this, my beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, for the anger of a man does not produce the righteousness of God. These three, quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger, are all summed up in this letter. At issue here is the righteousness of God. When someone wrongs us, the natural reaction is to what? Retaliate. At least verbally. But this response does not glorify God. Holding your tongue glorifies God. Leaving room for God's vindication demonstrates godly love, especially in very tense situations. Romans 12, 17 through 21. I had a situation one time where I didn't realize I cut the guy off on the highway. And I'm driving and I'm looking in my rearview mirror and this guy is racing to catch up with me. And I said, oh man, I must have did something wrong. And he's pulling up to my side. The guy is beet red. I mean, so you know the complexion. He was my brother of another mother. But so he was beet red in the face. When he pulled up to me, he pulled his window down, and I pulled my window down. I said, man, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me. All the air came out. What did I do? I heaped coals of fire on his head with love. A soft answer turned away wrath. And he looked at me and said, that's okay. And I'm gonna tell you, you only have a second to do that, guys. You know, these things can flip, can turn, but if you let the Holy Spirit, sometimes you just see Holy Spirit moment, listen to what he's saying, and he'll direct you correctly how to handle that situation. Since sin leads to death, obedience leads to life, and James is simply encouraging this behavior. Don't just hear, but do the word. Verse 25, it says the perfect law of liberty is the law of love. That's what it is. Loving God, loving neighbor sums up New Testament living. That's New Covenant living, folks. Verse 27, it talks about pure religion. It talks about the right kind of way of living. First of all, the Bible uses the word religion, but we really don't have religion. It uses it to give it context. Christianity is the only faith that has a person that redeems. Not only does he redeem, he's alive. He's very much alive and interacting with us constantly. The perfect law of liberty is the law of love. Love the Father, love God, love my neighbor, and then love myself. You see the paradigm, right? Vertical, horizontal. If the horizontal is affected, that means the vertical is off. There's a breach here. If you can't love people, no matter how they look, no matter what color they are, no matter what ethnicity they are, you need to go and come again. He needs to work on your heart. When you look at people, look at them and as the image of God. See, we got this race thing wrong, and I can really talk about it, but I ain't got time to talk about it right now. But we keep trying to go back to chapter 3 and fix things. That's the sin chapter. We got to go back to chapter 1 where he made us in his image and in his likeness. I was in Africa talking to the Africans, and I realized they looked at me as a black man. They were so proud. I'm on the stage with a couple of white guys, and they looked at, they said, they were so proud to see somebody that looks like them, that could articulate the gospel. And my friend who brought me, white guy, he said, man, I never brought a black guy here. He said, I only brought white guys. Now, he loved black folks, but he just never brought one there. He said, man, they are loving you. I said, Jamie, they're loving me because they see themselves in me. So proud. But does that mean you know when you have the love of God in your heart? When you're able to love people and you don't have the biases in between. That's where we got to get to. Racism is an issue of the heart. And y'all got it here, just in a different form. You know, if everybody was the same color, it'd be the big toe people and the little toe people. Because humanity would find some way to make the difference. Oh, let me see your toes. Oh no, y'all live over there. Y'all live over there. You ain't my people. I teach a thing called creaturism. And that's where this stuff starts. It starts with the creature. Us. It didn't start with the creator. It started with the creature. The perfect law of liberty is the law of love. Love God, love neighbor, sums up New Testament living, that's New Covenant living. Orphans and widows, and he talks about in verse 27, were the most vulnerable, unprotected in the ancient societal social structure. They were the most vulnerable and unprotected. As a matter of fact, they needed to be taken care of, cared for, or they just wasted away. Nobody cared about them. And salvation is the best demonstrated in its purest form when these people, and by keeping ourselves, when we love these people, and by keeping ourselves unstained from the influence of the world. And that's what he's talking about, pure religion. I hope you got something out of this, because I'm done. Thank you so much for giving me an ear tonight and enjoying the text, because I love the text. Let's pray. Father, we thank you tonight for your grace. Thank you, Lord God, for the study of your word. That's why we come together. Thank you for opening our hearts and our minds to hear what you have to say and illumine our thinking. We bless you for, God, for your, just for the grace of being able to understand what it is you mean in this ancient text. We comprehend it because you allow us to comprehend it. And you didn't make it hard and difficult because you wanted us to get it. So we bless you and thank you tonight. And I pray, God, that every believer both here and those online, Lord God, open their hearts to become more like you. More like you in every way, God. And as James has already told us, to get rid of that double-mindedness, be single in mind. God, deal with the temptation. Deal with the presentation of the temptation before it even becomes a temptation. God, I bless you and thank you because you've caused us to live an excellent life. We bless you in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.